Let us stand up and open up in prayer. Father, we come to you now in the name of Jesus. We thank you for this time. We thank you, Father, for this day. Close the door, please. We thank you, Father, that your word is alive and health and healing to all our flesh. And so as we come to you, Father, we come to you with a heart of thanksgiving. Thank you, Father, for this day. We thank you, Lord God, for your word. Oh, God, speak to our hearts today, Lord God. Help us to understand the importance of the new birth, being born again. Help us to see ourselves delivered from the powers of darkness, walking in the light of your word, free from the effects of sin. God, I give you all the praise and all the glory in advance in Jesus' mighty name, God. We can't do nothing in our own self, in our own strength, in our own abilities. But God, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us, because greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Father, we want to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. For it's in your name, Lord. It's in your name. And we thank you for it. Amen and amen. Well, glory to God, you may be seated. I want to thank God for you today, for all that what God is doing in our lives right now. Amen. Because we are in a time, we're in a day where God is being glorified. God is about to show himself strong, and God is about to be seen in the earth like never before. Because where sin abounds, the grace of God do much more abound. Amen. And so I believe that we're about to see the hand of God in our lives like never before. We're in that place, we're in that season, and I believe that time is at hand that God will begin to show himself strong on our behalf. Hallelujah. I just sense change. I sense change in the spirit realm. Amen. I sense change. And that change will come when we come to the knowledge of who we are and share that knowledge with those around us. Amen. Salvation is not something that we obtain just to say that we're born again. Salvation is to be shared with those around us, those that are around the world, those that are in our midst. Everywhere we go, we need to be able to share what God has done for us, because they need to see us as different than they are. Amen. Because if we've been looked upon the same as the world looked upon, then we can see why all the riots and everything is breaking out. Amen. Because see, we're stooping down to the world's level. We're stooping down to the world's level. But if we maintain who we are, we maintain who we are in Christ Jesus and take that bold stand of faith to rise above the situation that we are experiencing in the earth today, we will be noticed as the church of power. Amen. Power for what? Power to overcome adversity. Power to overcome the spirit of prejudice. Amen. Segregation. Amen. Religion. Everything that's against the will of God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And so I believe that God is going to do something in our life. Amen. Because we are coming to understand salvation and the new birth. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Woo, glory. You know, it's just so awesome to see the kingdom of God being manifest on our behalf. Amen. The kingdom of God is being manifest on our behalf. Glory to God. It's awesome. Oh, glory. Let me get this thing right here right real quick. It's just been... There we go. Now, because see, what we are doing, we are broadcasting this message abroad, and we want it all. We want the message to go out. In Jesus' name. Amen. And once it go out, we're going to see the hand of God moving across the radio wave, the televisions, and networks, and so forth and so on. Amen. Why? Because we're doing what God said to do. We're doing what God said to do. Regardless of what it looked like from a natural standpoint, God is still in control. Amen. How many of you, that message last week, how many was really ministered to by that message? I know that it ministered, I went back home and I listened to that message again. Amen. I listened to it twice, to tell you the truth, because it was speaking to me as well as it was to those that was sending out to. And the same way, I believe that God is going to speak to our hearts today, because I believe that we are in a time where we need to pay close attention to what God is doing and what God is wanting to do in our lives today. Amen. Today. Because today is the day that we will see the hand of God like never before. Because of what we're experiencing in the earth, I believe that we're going to see the hand of God like never before. Amen. Amen. And so I want to just call your attention to what the Word of God. But first of all, I want to acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord. Regardless of what we're going through, regardless of what we're experiencing, Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. Amen. Now I got this all set. Now we can get going. Amen. Glory to God. I made a few notes, and we're going to just believe that God's going to use us today. But before I would like to sing you all a song. I would like to sing a song I would like to dedicate to those that are seeking Christ. Those that are looking for a new beginning. This song is by Del Rey. The old man is dead. The old man is dead. Hallelujah, Lord God. We worship you. We praise you. We glorify you. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. This song reminds me of my past.
Now and then, an old friend of mine that I've not seen for some time would stop by and ask me, where have I been? What's on my mind? They wonder why I'm not drinking and still painting this old town red. But I tell them that I'm serving Jesus now. Life, I had no hope
inside.
I was lost in the darkness, yeah.
I was searching for the light.
But then one night in a little church, after hearing what the preacher said, I gave my heart to Jesus.
Jesus. God wants us to be exactly who he created us to be.
New creatures. He created us to be new creatures. Well, how do we become new creatures? By being born again. Amen. By being born again. By being washed in the blood of the Lamb. Amen. Glory to God. And so I want to just share with you today, because today is a good day to hear the word of God. Amen. Today is a good day to hear the word of God. And I want to just open up my heart today and share with you the things that God placed upon my heart. Because, see, I know that right now it is time to get back to the basis of salvation. What is the basis of salvation? What Jesus did for us at the cross. Why did he lay down his life for humanity? We need to get back to that and understand what he has done for us. Amen. Because your salvation was not wrought by you just being a good man or being a good woman. It was wrought by you accepting what Jesus did on Mount Calvary. Amen. They didn't take his life. He laid down his life. Amen. That you may have a chance to live a life. Amen. Separated from sin in this world. Amen. Jesus was tempted in all passion as we've been tempted, but yet he never sinned. And that being said, he gave us the power to walk upright before him by standing on the word of God. Amen. So we have an opportunity to live a life before God. Amen. Just as others have. Just as he has. Amen. How many of you know that God wants us to live a clean life and a holy life? Amen. So we want to understand what is the new birth. Amen. We need to understand that. Because, see, if we don't understand it, we could never walk in it. We could never walk in it unless we understand it. Second Corinthians chapter 5, let's go to that scripture. I just quoted it in my song there. But let's go to that scripture right now. Amen. And let's just go to that scripture right now and let's see what the word of God is saying to us. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, amen, and verse 17. Come on, let's just go there, because see, you need to understand that your past has been washed away. Because see, if you're still being affected by your past, then you can never advance into your future. You can never advance into your future if your past is holding you bound. If you're still in trouble because of your past, you still focus on your past failures, your past faults, the thing that you did. God has already paid the price for that. Amen. Jesus already paid the price for that. We're going to show you in the Word, man. Because, see, we need to understand that salvation, it came to us because of what Jesus did. And when we understand that, we can walk in salvation, knowing that if Jesus could be free of sin, amen, we can too. See, this is our ultimate goal, to be free. Our ultimate goal is to be free. And what I mean by free, because we all make mistakes. We all make mistakes, but that don't mean we dwell on the mistakes that we make. God made us to be free. Amen. He created us in His image and after His likeness. God is not bound by sin and iniquity. So why should you be bound by sin and iniquity? God has already sent His Son to the earth to pay the ultimate price. And what was the price that He paid? He gave up His own blood for your redemption. Oh, glory to His name. He gave His own blood for your redemption. In other words, He laid down His life for your freedom. Amen. For your deliverance. For you to be free from the penalty of sin. Amen. He laid down His life that you may have that peace of mind to know that you can be set free in every area of your life. Every area of your life. Amen. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 17, it says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is what? A new creature. A new creature. And then it says, all things are what? Passed away. See, this is what the problem is. We keep the body of Christ, even though God has said the old things are passed away, people are still focusing on their old nature, their old life, their history, their past, everything that they have done. And they make themselves in their own heart, they see themselves as unworthy to come before a holy God. And that is not true. That is a lie from the devil. God has already made a way for us to come before a holy God. How did He do it? Through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. He shed His blood for the redemption of humanity. For what I mean by redemption? He redeemed us. He redeemed us from sin. Not only did He redeem us from sin, He redeemed us from sicknesses and diseases. And He also redeemed us from poverty. Yes. Amen. So when we became a born again child of God, God set us free from sin. He set us free from lust. He set us free from pornography. He set us free from hate. He set us free from envy. He set us free from bitterness. He set us free from strife. He set us free from prejudice. He set us free from every hateful thing. Glory to God. But the problem is that we are so bound up by our past that we cannot see beyond our last failure. Because that last failure, you just capitalized on that last failure. And you just blown it up. It became bigger than it should have been. When all you need to do is say, Father, I have sinned. And I repent of my sin. I realize I sinned. I know in my heart I sinned because my own heart was grieved because of what I did. I know I sinned. I repent of that, Father, right now. And I turn away from it in Jesus' name. Father, I thank You for Your forgiveness. Because I confess my sin, I know that You are faithful and just to forgive me my sin and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we know that God will forgive us, but we got to be man enough or woman enough to acknowledge that we have done wrong. Amen. That alone will cause you to be free from guilt. It will cause you to be free from guilt. You know, people get guilt in their heart and it messes with you. It causes you to feel less than what God created you to be. Guilt is a destroyer of your conscience. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we need to understand
What we need to know about the new birth? We need to understand that the new birth is important for us to understand that's the truth of God. How can we tell the world that they in sin when we still held bound and when we're still in bondage from our past sin? Yeah, I'm asking you a question. How can we tell someone else that they can be free from sin when we're still held in bondage because of our past sin? We can't, because how can you get the mote out of someone else's eye when there's a beam in your own eye? You see, salvation, it must be declared among the people, and the people must understand that salvation had already been paid for. The ultimate price was given for your salvation, for your deliverance, for your freedom, for you to have a peace of mind. Amen? For you to have a peace of mind. It's not important what church you go to. What's important is the God that you serve. You can go to whatever church you want to go to, but if that church is not preaching a dead, buried, and risen Savior, then you need to check out what church you're in. Glory to God. Amen. Because the important thing is not what church you go to, but the family that you are becoming a part of. The family of God or the family of the devil? That's right, because there are two families. Amen. So we need to understand, which family are we becoming? Which family are we becoming a part of? The family of God? Amen. Or the family of the devil? Remember, the power of darkness is there to stop you from understanding. Every time you make a mistake, the devil says, "See, I told you you can't live for God." He does it on purpose. He wants to point his finger at you. What do you think he's doing to all those Christians that are running around and starting all these, you know, and all this uproar that's going around the world right now? What do you think, dog, that the devil is doing? He pointed all these Christians and said, "I told you you can't be a Christian." Every time I can just take someone's life, and all of a sudden, you were going to uproar because you don't understand who you are. And all it takes for me is just to start a little fire over here and a little fire over there and a little fire over there, and I can cause all you Christians to lose your salvation, to walk away from who you are as a child of God, because you become more focused on those things around you than you are on God and on what God has called you to do. Hallelujah. So we need to understand who we are. We need to understand that salvation is not something that we put on lightly. It's not something that we take lightly. It is something that we embrace. It's a way of life. It's a way of life. It's a way of life. Glory to God. Amen. So the key to unlock all the promises of God can be found in becoming a child of God. How do we become a child of God? How do we unlock the promise? How do we unlock the knowledge of who we are? Amen. Well, first of all, let's go to the book of John chapter 3. John chapter 3. We started on this on last Sunday, and praise the Lord. I'm going to go back there again because I know that we, as a children of God, we need to understand that salvation is so important that we need to have a biblical understanding of what is taking place in our hearts. How many people around the world that do not understand salvation? Amen. And they've been dominated every day by a demon spirit, and they don't even realize it. Their whole life is being governed by a demon spirit. Amen? And it's because salvation is not understood in the heart of man. Shh. Woo! Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. So God is coming. God is calling us to understand. God is calling us to pay attention to who we are. He's calling us to the knowledge of who we are. Amen. So we see right here, it says in verse number one, it says in verse one, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher that comes from God, because for no man can do the miracle that thou doest except God be with him." Amen. No man can do the miracle that thou doest except God be with him. Verse number three, Jesus answered and said unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee," now notice what he said, "except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Amen. Unless a man is focused on what Jesus did at the cross on Calvary and received it as for himself, that Jesus gave his life for his sin, he cannot see the kingdom of God. He cannot see the kingdom of God. Why? Because he don't understand what took place on Calvary. He don't understand what Jesus gave his life for. He don't understand that the purpose that Jesus went to the cross was totally for him. So if he don't understand it, how can he walk in the newness of life? How can he experience? How can he embrace? How can he come to understand the new birth? Unless he understands it all took place on Mount Calvary. At the cross. It was there by faith I received my sight. See, before I received my sight, I was blind because of darkness. And now I'm happy all the day. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. So we understand that when we come to the cross, see, 1 number 3, let's read it again. John chapter 3, verse 3. Jesus answered, said unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Well, how can we see the kingdom of God if we don't understand what it is? Amen. We don't understand when it come. We don't understand how it happened. Amen. How do we become a part of it? We became a part of it the moment we believed that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that he died for our sin. And we open up our heart willingly, without force. Without force. We open up our heart willingly and we accepted what Jesus did on the cross of Calvary. No matter what it looked like, no matter what the enemy is saying, we know for sure that my sins have been forgiven. Because I know when Jesus went to the cross, he took my sin and it was nailed to the cross. It was nailed to the cross. Now what I do today, is because I've kind of gotten away from that. When we come back to that, when we begin to refocus our attention on what really matters, then we can see that the wages of sin is still death. The wages of sin is death. And so when we know that we've sinned, we immediately repent of our sin that we have done. Amen. We immediately repent of the sin that we've done and ask God to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Why? Because God is wanting to do something so powerful in our life that we cannot be a part of the things of this world. We got to separate ourselves that we can see the will of God and the hand of God in our life today. Because today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of salvation. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is the new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Your old nature is the thing of the past. It has no power over you. The moment you begin to understand what Jesus did for you on Calvary, that past is nothing but what it is. It is the past. Now you need to begin to focus on the new life, the new nature, everything that God has created you to experience in this new life. God is calling you to advance your experience through the new birth. Amen. And how that's going to happen? By listening to what he has done. Listen to what he has said. Amen. The key which unlocks all the promise of God is been found in the new birth. Amen. So becoming born again, child of God, Jesus taught that a man must be born again. In other words, we have to follow the example that he had given us. What example he had given us? Notice what he said here in the book of Romans. Glory to God. We're going to come back over here in just a minute. But in the book of Romans, I want us to look at chapter 10. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. In the book of Romans, chapter 10, it says, let's look at verse number one first. Glory to God. Verse number one says, "Brethren, my heart desire and prayer for God for Israel lives that what? That they might be saved." See, God wants all men saved. He don't want none to go without the understanding of salvation. He wants all men to be saved. He said, verse number 2, "For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge." See, we don't have a true knowledge of salvation. Therefore, we are not living in the fullness of our salvation. Therefore, we have been dominated. We've been brought in remembrance of our past, and our past is trying to keep us in bondage when God has set us free. And he that the Son has set free, the Bible said, is free indeed. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. So when my past sort of raised up his ugly head, my heart is to understand that death has already been dealt with. In my heart, I should understand that death's already been dealt with. Death is no more a part of me. My life is hid in Christ Jesus right now. Amen. My life has been hid in Christ Jesus. And everything that I did in my past before I accepted Jesus Christ in my heart, those things are in the past. And I should not allow it to bother me anymore. Why? Because I'm a new creature, created in Christ Jesus. Unto what? Good works. Unto good works. Amen. Now, notice what it said right here in Romans chapter 10, verse number 3. It said, For they being ignorant of God's righteousness, going about to establish their own righteousness, not submitting themselves to the righteousness of God. So many people trying to do their own thing, it's education is good. And I don't knock it one bit. I love education. Amen. But some people have educated themselves so much that they have outsmarted themselves. They know more than God now. They know more than God now. Amen. And so we need to understand that we cannot look at ourselves above. See, that's what Satan did. He said, I will be like the Most High. He said, I exalt my throne above the heights of God, above the stars of God. Amen. And I will be like the Most High. And when he said that, he was cast down to the earth. Why? Because he had set himself up to be above God. To be above God. That was a spirit of deception. That same spirit of deception is in the earth today. It's in the earth today. And this is why so many people are not understanding their new birth, because they have been so humanized instead of spiritualized. They've become so caught up in knowledge of the world that they have lost the knowledge of Christ and of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So he tells us right here now, let's go down to verse number eight. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart, and that is the word of faith which we preach. Now notice in verse number 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So how am I going to be saved? How am I going to know that I'm saved? If I open up my heart, believe what Christ did at the cross, accepting what he had done at the cross and receiving it as he had done it, especially for me. Amen. As though I'm the only man in the earth. As though I'm the only man in the earth. Amen. So he died on the cross just for me. He died on the cross just for me. He gave his life just for me to be able to stand before God. Amen. So you can say that by yourself. You can say, he died on the cross so that you will be able to stand before God. Amen. So that you will be able to stand before God. Because that's what he did, folks. That's what he did. He laid down his life. They didn't take his life. He laid down his life that we may have a right to the tree of life. To the tree of life. To the tree of life. Glory to God. It says, verse number 10, it says, for with the heart man believes. See, if I don't believe it, then it don't apply to me. Salvation don't apply to me unless I can believe it in my heart. The new birth doesn't apply to me unless I can believe it in my heart. Being born again doesn't apply to me because I don't have an understanding of it in my heart. Because if I don't understand it, how can I accept something that I don't understand? I can't. Neither can you. But the moment I began to understand what Jesus did for me, now I can understand that it was just for me. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. So when people are rebelling against one another, amen, let's look at 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. See, when Christians go to acting out of order because of anger and bitterness, then they're stepping out of the will of God, and it's totally been led by the devil. Amen. Totally been enforced by demon spirits. Demon spirits are behind it all. Amen. And so we look here in 1 Peter chapter 2. In 1 Peter chapter 2, I want us to look at verse number 23. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse number 23. And it says, who when he was reviled not again. When they came against Jesus, Jesus did not come back against them. Amen. Why? Because he knew who he was. He didn't have to fight fist for fist. He didn't have to use gun for gun. He didn't have to use a stick for stick, a word for word. Amen. He stepped back and he realized, hey, I'm above this. I don't have to become involved with this. I see what the enemy is doing, and he's trying to ignore me into reacting against the will of God for my life. It's not the will of God. See, God said, turn the, if you slap your one cheek, do what? Turn the other cheek. Do not rebel against him just because he hit you. Do not rebel against him because he hurt you. Do not rebel against him because he took a life. Do you go and take a life just because he took a life? But that's what the world is doing. That's what the church is starting to do. The people of God is out in the street rioting because they see what they see in injustice being done. Do that mean they shouldn't have injustice in their heart because the world has brought injustice in their heart against us? No. God has called us to understand the new birth. The new birth is a part. That means we have accepted in the kingdom. And in the kingdom, there's power over the power of darkness. But we enforce that power through prayer. We enforce that power through prayer, not by becoming a part of what's going on. Understanding who we are in the new birth and walking in the knowledge of that enforces God's power by praying. God said in his word, I sought Ezekiel chapter 22 and verse 30. I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land that I would not destroy. But he said, I found none. I found none. And it's because everybody's so caught up in self, they can't see beyond their natural thinking. Because they so much want to, they want to show that I'm big and strong just like you are. I can do what you do. Don't be so smart that you become ignorant concerning the things of God. Whew. Where's all this coming from? We got to walk in the knowledge of who we are. But instead, we're falling down to the world's level. To the people of the world's level. And we've been pushed around by demon spirits, and we don't even see it. We don't even see it. God said, behold, I give you power over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing shall by enemies hurt you. Salvation, friend, is more than just saying, I'm born again. Salvation is a lifestyle God has called us to live. Being born again means I'm separated from this world. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So look at First Peter chapter 2, verse number 23 again. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 23. Who when he was reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not. See, Jesus never reacted. Amen. Because people was threatening him. And this is part of it. Now, who's writing this letter? Peter? So they must have learned something in order to be able to put it in black and white. They had to see this in action. They had to understand it in their heart in order for them to write it out. Amen. God had to reveal it to them in order for them to write it out. Now, notice what he said in verse number 23. Verse number 23, one more time. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 23. Who, when he was reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously. He stayed with his conviction. He stayed with his heart focused on who had called him. He didn't allow the enemy or the devil to manipulate him, to get him off focus. But look at the world today. How they of being how the church is falling in line with what the world is doing, because they don't understand the power that they have in the new birth. The cross has lost its effect in their life. Hallelujah. To understand the new birth, then you must understand born again. You must understand salvation. You must understand what happened at the cross. Let's throw Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4. Just back it up a few pages. Hebrews chapter 4. And look at verse number 14 and 15. Hebrews chapter 4. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest. Now know what I'm about to say, folks. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our what? Infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are. Like as we are. Yet, notice what he said, the last three words. Yet without sin. Yet without sin. So when he was reviled against when they reviled against him, he didn't react to their revile against him. He didn't revile back at them. Because had he did, it would have been an act of sin. And he knew who he was. Amen. And God said, he said, look, we need to come to the knowledge of who we are. We need to know who we are. How can we withstand temptation when we don't understand the power that lives in us? Amen. We have power to be free from every demonic force that is coming against us. Jesus knew that he could not overcome sin alone. So what did he do? He spent time with his Father in prayer. Every time he had an opportunity, he separated himself and he went and prayed. Why was he praying? He was praying because he knew in his own self, in his own ability, he could not, because see, he put off this royal robe of his deity. And he came to this earth as a natural man. As a natural man, he was tempted just like we are tempted. Amen. Of the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, and all this stuff, so just we are. But the thing about it is that how did he overcome? He overcame by standing in the presence of God, praying, seeking the face of God. And that's what God called us to do today. He's called us to pray. He called us to seek his face. Amen. Jesus knew he could not overcome sin alone. But his love for God calls him to have a godly fear inside of his heart. See, this is the problem today. The church don't have any godly fear in their hearts. Woo! Glory to God. Because if there was a godly fear in their heart, when things are going off so wild like it's going off right now, instead of them wanting to retaliate with anger, with bitterness, with strife, and rebelling against one another, they will retaliate with prayer. They will call out upon the name of the Lord. But instead, they'd rather fight. Like they always said by the old cigarette, they'd rather fight than switch. Still caught up in the things of this world. And God is saying, enough is enough. We must see ourselves rising above the storms of life. We must see ourselves walking in that which God has called us to walk in. Let's turn to Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. In Colossians chapter 2, I want to start reading verse number 6. I want to start reading with verse number 6. Yeah. It's tight, but I know I'm right. I know I'm right, folks. I know that God is speaking to our hearts. Amen. So verse number 6 says, as ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. See, we've been commanded to walk in him. We've been commanded to turn the other cheek. We've been commanded to not revile against evil. Amen. We have been commanded not to be like the world. But instead, we are showing our old nature because we have not realized that we've been dead to sin. Notice what it said in verse number 6. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord. This is Colossians chapter 2, verse 6. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted, built up in him, established in the faith, as ye have been taught, abiding therein with thanksgiving. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the rudiment of men, after the tradition of the world. There it is. After the tradition of the world. Glory to God. And not after Christ. The world is trying to pull you and trying to bring you out of your reality of being God indwelt than just to be just a mere normal human being in the earth. When God has called you out, you're in this world, but you're not of this world, folks. You've been called out of this world. You are seated right now in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, far above principalities and powers and might and dominion. These things that are happening in this earth has no power over you, but because you have a lack of understanding of the new birth, these things are ruling your life still. Hallelujah. Verse number 3 said, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiment of the world, not after Christ. For in him, now notice what he said, verse number 9. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. But because we are not abiding totally in him, the Godhead that God has revealed to us, that he has imparted to us, does not have an effect in us. Because we are yielding to the demonic spirits that we're just like puppets on a string. We want to, if the enemy do something over here, we all unite together and revile against it. And we want to go and block out walk across the highways or across the interstate and block all the traffic on a protest. Because some demon spirit is pushing you, is pushing your buttons. And you want to go and jump on a building, you want to start shooting people just because a demon is pushing your buttons. And then you want to start an uproar throughout the whole nation because a demon is pushing your button. It's time to pray. It's time to pray like we've never prayed before. It's time to speak against the principalities and against the powers and against the rulers of the darkness of this world and against the spiritual wickedness in high places. It's time for us to put on the whole armor of God and be the children of God that he created us to be, walking in our salvation, understanding who we are, and understanding the power that we possess as children of Almighty God. Oh, Shekalala Basaya. Glory to God. Glory to God. Verse number 9 says, Colossians chapter 3, chapter 2, and verse number 9. Glory to God. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are, notice what he said, complete in him. But if you're not abiding in him and he's not abiding in you, there's no way that the completeness of God can abide in you. Because you're still caught up in what the world is doing and what the world is saying. You're not understanding who you are as a child of God. Folks, we need to wake up. We need to wake up. We need to understand our priorities. Glory to God. Glory. My God, my God, my God. The Holy Ghost is speaking today. Hallelujah. Glory to God. See, the Bible says in verse number 10, and ye are complete in him, which is the head of all. Notice what it said, which is the head of all principalities and power. So if we are complete in him, which is the head of all principalities and power, when we begin to understand our nature, the nature of God that's in us, begin to set up, begin to take authority, begin to speak the word of God over these situations, this fullness of God in us will begin to take revenge for us. We don't have to revenge ourselves. And this is what the world is doing. This is why there's so much anger and bitterness in the world, because the world, the people of the house of God and the people of the world are united together instead of the church united together. They want to unite with the world. God said, how can two agree except they what? How can two walk together except what? They be in agreement. How can the light agree with darkness? How can light and darkness have fellowship together? So that showed me that that we as a church are lacking in our lives. We are lacking the knowledge of who we are. We are lacking the knowledge of the new birth. We are lacking the knowledge of salvation. If we don't understand it, we will never walk in, and we will be a defeated foe, because we are yielded to our demon spirit. We need to repent. The church needs to repent. Hallelujah. Verse number. Where am I at? Verse number 10 again. And ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principalities and power. In whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hand, and putting off. Now notice what he said, for this is very important, and putting off the body of sins of the flesh. Because it's the sins of the flesh that is causing you to see, just like my wife was saying this morning, there's an open door in the life of so many of God's people that need to be shut. You have an open door in your heart. There's an open door in your life. And what that open door is, it could be whatever that is not complying with God. Amen. It could have a door open that make you receptive to the things that is going on around you rather than what God has said to you. See, God has called us to be free. How many of you have a desire to totally be free? God wants us free in every area of our life. Free from lust, free from pornography, free from anger, free from bitterness, free from fighting, free from cussing. How many like to cuss every once in a while? God wants you free from that too. That's right. And every generational curse. Because you see, there are demon spirits that is promoting these things. And we, as the children of God, need to understand that who that Son has set free is free indeed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Amen. So it says in verse number 12, says, buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are raised with him through the faith of the operation of God who had raised him from the dead, and you being dead in your sin, notice what he said, verse number 13, and you being dead in your sin and the uncircumcision of your flesh, had he quickened together with him, amen, having forgiven. See, you have been forgiven, because when you accepted Jesus Christ in your heart, when you received salvation, you were dead, you were buried with him, amen, according to the word right here, verse number 13, Colossians chapter 3, chapter 2, verse number 13. You being dead in sin, in your sin, and the circumcision of your flesh, had he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespass. See, you've been forgiven. As a born-again child of God, you have been forgiven. Amen. But unless you understand it, you will still walk around with that guilt conscience. Verse number 14, blotted out the handwriting of ordinances which was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way. Now notice what he did, nailing it to the cross. Nailing it to the cross. Your sins, your iniquities, everything that God delivered you from when you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it's already been nailed to the cross. You have been forgiven. You just got to learn how to forgive yourself now. Your conscience is still dwelling on your past when God has said, renew your mind. How can we walk away from our past when we still are not renewing our mind? Amen. How do we renew our mind? Glory to God. I want you to look with me. Now, let's finish reading this first. Verse number 15. Verse number 15. And having spoiled principalities and power, he made a show of them openly, trampling over them in it. Let no man therefore judge you. See, God don't want you to be judged because you made a mistake. He wants you to repent when you make a mistake. He wants you to repent when you make a mistake. Don't continue in it. That man will point their finger at you and say, I told you you wasn't a Christian. I told you that you will never make it. The devil, he wants to bring condemnation in your heart. Instead of you walking by faith, you're walking by condemnation. And you know, only one being hurt is you as a believer. Because you don't see yourself the way God sees you. And so you're hurting your own self by not rising above what the world sees you as. Because the world sees you as them. That's the way the world sees you. That's the way the world sees the church today. The world don't see the church as a powerful entity in the earth. And this is why God is saying to us, it's time to preach the cross. It's time to come back to the cross. We must preach salvation. We must preach deliverance. We must preach born again. It's time, folks. It's time. The power of God is at the cross. We got to come back to the cross. We got to preach deliverance. We got to preach salvation. We got to warn the people of the sin that they're in. Otherwise, their blood is going to be required to our hand. We must tell them. We must let them know that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's by one man has sinned and entered into this world, so death by sin. So death passes on all men, for all have sinned. And we must tell them. We cannot allow the world to take the light out of the church, because the world is coming into church and being a part of the church to pollute those that are in the church. And we got to be strong. We got to be strong. So let's look at Philippians chapter, let's back it up another couple pages. Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4. And I want you to look at verse number 13. Are y'all with me today? Philippians chapter 4, verse number 13. And it says, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. In other words, folks, whatever the enemy is trying to bring against you, you can overcome it through Christ that strengthens you. You can rise above what the enemy is saying, and you can see yourself in a place of authority and power, and you acting on what God has said will bring you to a place of inner peace. Why? Because you're standing on the word of peace. You stand on the word of life because God is standing with you. Amen. He's given you the strength to overcome the kingdom of darkness. Amen. And so how do we do that? Let's look at Colossians again, chapter 3. Let's go back a few pages. Go back over a few pages. Forward. Colossians chapter 3. And I want us to look at this time verse number 5. Because see, this is the area that keeps us in our past. This is the area that keeps us in bondage. We need to overcome this area of our lives. We need to overcome it. Colossians chapter 3 and verse number 5 says, mortify, therefore, your members. In other words, your body. Amen. Mortify, therefore, your members which are upon the earth. Notice what he said. Fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil, concupiscence, and covetousness, which is adultery, for which thing, say, the wrath of God cometh upon whom? The children of disobedience. The children of disobedience. Notice that verse number 7. In which ye also walk sometime when ye live in them. See, you walk like that yourself when you was without Christ. But God is calling us to a new walk. He called us to understand the new birth. He's called us to understand our salvation has made us free from the law of sin and death. Amen. How do we know? Because Jesus was tempted in like passion as we are. And by the Spirit of God, He has given us the power to overcome or to stay strong in Him. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So, mortify therefore the members of which are upon the earth. Fornication, uncleanness, inordinacy, affection, evil, concupiscence, and covetousness, which is adultery. God wants us to be free from these things in our lives. Because these are the areas that open up the door for the enemy to have a stronghold in our lives, which keep us in bondage to our past. Now I know that none of us in here have no problem dealing with our past. But I want to tell you the difference. We all have problems, amen, in this area. Because we're all human. We all still live in this earth. We all still live in this flesh. We are in this world, but we're not of this world. So we still have to deal with everything that everyone else is dealing with. And we have to learn that we've been given power over all the powers of the enemy so that we will not be caught up in these things. Amen? Am I making sense to any of y'all today? Amen. Now, the ultimate goal, since we're here so close, let's look at Galatians, the book of Galatians, right before Ephesians. Galatians. And I want you to look at chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2. Because God is calling us, folks, to understand the new birth. And He called us to understand that we have to. See, Jesus, he had to pray. And the disciples of old had to pray. What makes you think that you can live a life of God without praying? You can't. Notice what it says right here in Galatians chapter 2 and verse number 20. He said, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. See, Paul said, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. But see, he realized that he couldn't live this life in his own self. He realized he couldn't make it on his own. So he said, Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ that lives in me. He yielded to the Spirit of God that was on the inside of him. Amen. Nevertheless, not I, but Christ lived in me. Then he said, for the life that I now live, what? In the flesh, I live by what? The faith of the Son of God. I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me, who gave himself for me. So when we understand what God has did for us, we can live it by faith. We know that he did it. We can live by faith. God, you deliver me. I believe that. That settles it in my heart. Therefore, when sin becomes, when sin comes in my presence, I'm going to look at it, and I'm going to say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I will not allow my mind to think along these lines. I will not dwell on these thoughts. I cast them down. I bring my thoughts into captivity to the Holy Ghost, and I yield my spirit to you. Amen. Cast down everything imaginary that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. This is how we remain free, folks. Cast down every vain imagination and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Because the devil, he's going to continually bring these things up before you. And before you know it, if you don't cast them down, it's going to become a part of your life. Because you're going to yield to it. You're going to begin to talk about it. Because what you look upon the most, you're going to start dwelling on those things in your mind and in your heart. Then you're going to start talking about it. And once you start talking about it, you might as well get ready, because you're about to yield your whole memory into that direction. So you need to bring every memory, every thought into captivity to the Holy Ghost. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. See, Nicodemus, let's go back to chapter 3 again. John chapter 3. We're going to close with this. John chapter 3. And we're going to pick back up on this next Sunday. So y'all make sure you tell everybody to join us on next Sunday. Because, see, we're not done with it. We just started on this. John chapter 3, verse number. Let's verse number 3 again. John chapter 3, verse number 3. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. How can we see the kingdom of God manifest in our lives and in the earth through us if we are still bound by our past? 2 Corinthians 5:17 said, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things become new. Amen. And so he said in verse number 4, Nicodemus said unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered and said unto him, Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit. Notice what he said, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit. Of the water and of the Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. He cannot, notice what he said this time, you cannot enter, oh glory to God, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. How do we enter the kingdom of God? We enter the kingdom of God through salvation. But except you're born of the water and of the Spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. So we must understand it. We must have an understanding in our heart what Jesus has done for us. In order for us to even step out of this old nature into the new nature that he has brought for us. Because we need to not just step out, we need to understand what we're stepping into. Because if we don't understand it, we're going to continue with the old nature. I got to take you one more verse. Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. Then we're going to close. Romans chapter 12, verse number 1. Says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body. See, this is something we have to do. We have to give God permission to work on us. We have to present our bodies to him that he will have something to work on. Amen. So we present our body to him as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is our reasonable service. Verse number 2 says, and be not conformed to this world. So many of us have been so conformed to this world that we can't see where God is going to lead us. Because we've been so brainwashed. We've been so caught up dealing with the things of this world that he has taken our attention off the things that God wants us to understand and to know. Amen. So he says, verse number 2, he says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. So if I'm going to walk in the newness of life, if I'm going to walk in the fullness of the Godhead bodily, then I got to be transformed my thinking. I got to have my thinking to be re-transformed. I can't continue to think the way I think all my life from this point up until now and expecting God's best in my life because I'm still caught up on my past. I have to let go of my past and I have to embrace my present in order to enter into my future. Y'all understand that, right? You got to let go of your past in order to embrace your present so you can enter into your future. Because there's a destiny that is laid out for each and every one of us. And in order for us to reach that destiny, we must understand that we are the body of Christ. And Satan has no power over us because we overcome evil with good. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Amen. So it says in verse number 2, it says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. You got to renew your mind. You got to stop looking at everything and you got to start renewing your mind. You got to. It's important. Renew your mind that you may prove the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Amen. You need to understand the will of God is not following after the things of this world, not being pushed around by every demon out there, but by being led by the Spirit of the living God. For they that are the children of God are led by the Spirit of God, not being pushed around by some demon trying to start uproars, trying to start fights, trying to start riots. You're not a child of the devil. You're churches of the light. So let us walk in. Glory to God. Father, in the name of Jesus, I have declared that what you have placed within my heart for this day. Now, Father, I ask you to let this word go forth and minister to every heart that you have designed to speak to. And let them hear what the Spirit of God is saying. Let us be yielded vessels to righteousness and not to that which is evil. Let us not abhor evil in our hearts. Let us not look for revenge. Let us not want to revel against our enemy. But let us hold fast to the profession of our faith as children of Almighty God. If we have to turn the left cheek, then let us turn the other cheek. But let us not be pulled away from who we are as children of God. Father, I ask you right now in Jesus' name to strengthen your people. Give us the will to carry out your assignment in the earth, to go ye into all the world and to preach the gospel to every creature, and not join in the world, but to preach the gospel to every creature. And let them come to the knowledge of being born again, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, walking in the new birth, understanding the new birth, experiencing the power of the new birth, knowing that we are not alone, but that you're with us and that your word and your spirit will comfort us, will strengthen us, will cause us to rise above the storms of life, even if necessary to walk on the waters of life, right in the midst of our circumstances and trials and tribulations. God, your word has the power to raise us up that we will see ourselves differently than what the world is looking upon us to be. For we are your people, the sheep of your pasture. We enter into your gates, Father, with thanksgiving, and into your courts with praise. I speak blessings over your people. I cancel every argument in the spiritual realm right now over your people. And I release the spirit of faith right now to begin to rise up in the heart of your people, Lord God, that they will not act out evil for evil, but that they will turn their hearts to serve the true living God. Father, I thank you for it. In advance, in Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Y'all get anything out of this today?
Yes, amen.
Amen. I tell you, it's something that I know that God is speaking to my heart, and I know it's all because of spending quality time with him in prayer. Amen. God wants us to understand that we are our brother's keeper. Amen. That we are our brother's keeper. And when we pray, when we intercede for the body of Christ, we're saying, God, Let not the enemy triumph. Let not the enemy triumph over your heritage. But God, keep them in the hollow of your hand. Amen. That's what it's all about, folks. Bringing God's heart on the scene. Connecting his heart to your heart. Amen. Through faith and prayer. Amen. Well, it is time for us to take about morning offering. Amen. Those of you that's going to be giving through the internet. Amen. Those of you that's going to be giving through the internet, through the mail system, the mail postal service. Amen. We want you to prepare your offering right now. God, speak to the heart of your people all across the network audience and those that are here in the church, God. Father, we realize, Father, that we can't do nothing in our own strength, even in the area of finances, God. If we are looking for a multiplication in our finances, we got to learn to be cheerful givers in our finances. So, Father, I ask you in Jesus' name, because I know it's your will that the spirit of poverty be broken off of your people. It is your will for your people to experience the fullness of life, even in the area of their finances. Now, Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you and I bless your people right now in the name of Jesus. You that are going to be giving by the internet, you may go to my website, libraryministries.com, and you may use your ATM card, your credit card there to plant your seed of faith. Amen. And those of you that's going to be going through the mail system, postal service system, you make your check payable to Larry Ministries, that's P.O. Box 417913, Sacramento, California, 95841. Again, that's make your check payable to Larry Ministries, that's P.O. Box 417913, Sacramento, California, 95841. Amen. Now, as you get your offering ready, amen, we're going to prepare our hearts to come in agreement with you for your need to be met in every area of your life. Amen. We believe in God for your home to be paid off, that you be out of debt. We believe God for you to be debt-free. We believe God for your property to be paid in full. Amen. That all you owe each year is your property taxes. Amen. But no monthly mortgage. We believe in God for your monthly mortgage to be paid in full. Amen. That you will be free from monthly mortgages. We believe in God for your car to be paid off. We believe in God that you will have no overhead, no debt to stop you from giving to the King of God right now in these last days. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for every man and every woman that is going to be given today, Lord God. I pray a supernatural blessing over them, Father, as they give. Father, let it be given back to them. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give unto their bosom, Father. And Father, with the same measure that they meet with all, let it be measured to them again. As they give willingly and cheerfully, Lord God, I pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, that the kingdom of darkness that has come against their finances, that has come against their well-being, that has come against their health, that has come against their loved ones, Father, in the name of Jesus, I declare that the enemy is rebuked, the devourer is rebuked, because you said, Father, when we give, it shall be given unto us, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give unto our bosom. And God, you have said in your word that you rebuke the devourer for our sake. So, Father, we declare that we're out of debt. We declare that the devourer rebuke. We're out of debt. We have plenty to put in store. And, Father, I thank you for houses being paid off. I thank you, Lord God, that mortgage is being canceled in Jesus' name. I thank you, Father, for cars being paid off, hospital bills. Oh, glory to God. Someone, you have an outstanding hospital bill, and you've been praying, Lord, how can I pay my hospital bill? You don't have enough to pay that hospital bill. God said, that what you have is a seed. God said, sow that seed right now in this ministry, and you will see a miracle breakthrough in your life. I'm just obeying God now. You can take it for what it's worth. Someone that's listening to me, you have a great, outstanding hospital bill, and you don't have the money to pay the hospital bill. You only have a seed. Give God that seed. Release that seed right now and expect your miracle. I'm coming in agreement with you right now because I know God spoke it and I know the miracle is waiting for your obedience. Amen. For that miracle to come about, it requires your obedience. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for that person or those persons, Lord God, who have that need, Father, of a financial breakthrough because of a hospital bill. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you, Lord God, that supernaturally they will release their faith and receive this word, God, and step out by faith and activate this word in their life, Father. And as soon as they do, Lord, that you're going to release that miracle on their behalf, Father. Debt free. Debt free. That bill is canceled in Jesus' name. I declare it. I decree it now in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Glory to God. Amen. Glory to God. Did everybody give that want to give? Father, in the name of Jesus, we hold up this offering before you right now, Father. And God, we declare and decree, Father, that everything that you have spoken concerning those that are giving right now, Father, we declare and decree that it is true and that it shall be performed. As they give, it shall be given unto them. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give back into their bosom. I thank you, Father, for debt cancellation. I thank you, Father, for houses paid in full. Car was paid off in the name of Jesus. Hospital bills paid off in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Father, that every need is met in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Now, I will encourage you to obey God. Amen. God has spoken. And for you to have that promise in your life, you must obey God. You must obey God. Amen. Amen. You may be listening today, you may be here today, you never made Jesus Christ Lord of your life. Or you may be here today, you listen today, you want to rededicate your life to the Lord. Amen. You're tired of being living. You're tired of living a defeated life. And to hear this message, you realize that you must be born again. And I know that even though that we are born again, there's a lot of us that are not living the Christian life. Amen. Because we have been deceived. And God says, be not deceived, for God is not mocked. Amen. For God is not mocked. And he's telling you right now, as you have sold to the flesh, you have of the flesh, read corruption. But God said, today is the day of turnaround for your life. Today is the day of a new beginning for many. Amen. So there are some that never asked Jesus Christ yet to come into their hearts. And Jesus is giving you the opportunity today to ask him to come into your heart and to forgive. And he's asking you to repent, that he will forgive you of your sin. And he's going to come into your heart right now to give you a brand new lease on life. Amen. And you that have backslid, have turned away from God because of circumstances, because of situations, because of deception, God is saying to you, return to me and I will return to you, said the Lord. And I will strengthen you. Yea, I will help you. I will uphold you by the power of my right hand. And I will be your God. You shall be my people. Amen. So God is talking to us. Amen. If you're one of these people, one that have never had Christ come in your life, or maybe you have, but you backslid, want to rededicate your life, I'm talking to you right now. Amen. Say this prayer with me. Say this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I'm not worthy to be called your son. But Lord, I realize my wrong. I realize my error. I repent of my sin. And I ask you to come into my heart, create in me a right spirit, and renew in me a clean heart. Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God, and that you died for my sin. As I believe this in my heart, and confess it with my mouth, I receive you today as my Lord and my Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Amen. If you said that simple prayer, right now the angels in heaven are rejoicing because of you. Amen. God knows where you are, and he's meeting you right where you are. You don't have to do nothing special. All you got to do is be sincere from your heart. Amen. And God will do the rest. And then, once God come in and created you that right spirit, find yourself a church that is teaching the truth. Don't sit at home and just look at a computer, look at a television. Amen. Find a place where you can go and have fellowship with people that is headed in the same direction that you're believing for. Amen. Because God has a people out there just like you was born again. There are people that are born again headed in the same direction that he wanted you to go. And they can help you to be strengthened in every area of your life. Amen. God bless you. If you're here today, you have a special prayer request right now. I will pray for you. I will pray for you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for my dear sister. God, I ask you in the name of Jesus that you would touch, that you would minister, that you would strengthen. I bind every spirit of infirmity, sickness, and disease, and I lose it from her life right now. And I release the spirit of life, the spirit of health, the spirit of healing in the name of Jesus to flow through every fiber of her being. I release it by faith in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. Anybody else want prayer? Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You look cute today. Look at you. Amen. Both of y'all. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for these two young ladies. And as I lift them up before you, Father, I release your anointing, Father, from the crown of their head to the soles of their feet. I bind every spirit of infirmity, sickness, and disease. I loose it from them right now. I release divine health and healing to flow freely in their veins, Lord God, pushing out and cleaning out every demonic spirit that will try to interfere with their health and their blood system, Father. I release the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus Christ to flow through their blood system, cleaning up their blood, Father, in the name of Jesus, with health and healing. I release the life and the nature of God in Jesus' name to flow throughout their being. And God, I thank you for divine help, divine healing in every area of their life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Anyone else? Glory to God. Everybody all right? Let's pray for those that are listening, by those that are watching and viewing. Father, in the name of Jesus, you that are listening right now, just reach your hand out right now. Just reach out, stretch out your hand toward me right now. Father, as they stretch their hand out toward me right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray, Father, as a point of contact, I lay my hand upon my head, and Father, as a contact with them, I bind every spirit of infirmity, sickness, and disease that will try to come against their life, that will try to come against their health. Father, I release the life and the nature of God, the blood of Jesus Christ, to flow right now. Father, they're driving out every unclean spirit that is trying to affect their blood system in the name of Jesus. I bind up that spirit in the name of Jesus that is trying to interfere, that spirit of infirmity, that spirit of sickness and disease that is trying to enter their bloodstream. I rebuke it in Jesus' name, and I loose you from your assignment. And Father, I release divine health and healing from the crown of their head to the soles of their feet right now in Jesus' name. Father, let them open up their heart by faith and receive that right now. Receive it by faith in Jesus' name. I thank you for it. Amen and amen. God bless you. I want y'all to join us on Tuesday night at 6:30 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Amen. And we will be live again. And we want you to be blessed, ministered to, and touched by the Spirit and by the presence and by the Word of God. God bless you. We love you. Until then, have a good day. Bye-bye.
I thank God for you, and I pray that God touches your life as he has touched as many as received his word. God bless you. This is Pastor Larry. Have a good day. Bye-bye.